I pray my righteousness on. Judgment proceed right from your throne, but my mediator. Yeah, I know my righteousness dirty. Make my enemies show peace instead of letting them hurt me. Help me to see clearly when the waters are murky. Hide me in the day of adversity right under your wings. Yeah, I'ma keep it a buck. If my brother is starving, I put some food in his guts. And for no amount of money am I giving him up. If he falls, I be picking him up till the kingdom comes. I'm right. That's where them cherubims be. Why the 24 elders throwing their crowns at your feet? The Lord said to my Lord, son, come take a seat till I put the enemies up under your feet. So he at the right hand.
With all your heart, breathe the breath in your life, man, with skater spark. Holy Spirit giving classes, I'm pulling up a chair. Furnace of adversity, know the Father will be there right. Put the armor on, weapons are not carnal. Fighting off these demons like fire, I'm the marshal. Bricklayer stacking up all these riches in heaven. Pray to the Lord, you taking out all the leaven, right? Call on your help, we give all the praises to Abba. Funeral arranged, I'm burying all the problems. Lay the wood in order, take a lamb to slaughter. Say a 50-17, lost sheep at the border, right? Trial, tribulation, and problem vexing my soul. Security protector, I'm fast and paying the toll. Marathon, not a race, endurance is the key. Long distance running to the kingdom, I can see it right.
Days, despite of my ways and past dealings, dealing the haze. Product of the circumstances, wasn't how I was raised. You changed my ways and paths, so I give you the praise. I hope I'm when it's said and done. Was toting a gun and hustled to secure me some funds. I was standing on business, not the one that will run. Now I'm by my Father's business and I walk with the Son. I'm right. Can't slip or stumble, trip or tumble, break down, flip or fumble. Enduring to the end, trying not to rip or crumble. Stand firm. 10 toes, sincere and humble, right? Amos 3:3, of course I agree. Was wicked, unfortunately. Not 180 die daily, that's fortunately. Not on that Donald Jones shit, know where I wanna be, that's right.
Where's our separation? Because you say you've talked to Israelites. Where is your belief and your understanding that separates from our belief? Because everything you said, we believe in.
That's cool, but the difference is I believe Jesus is also God, too.
Whoa. Give me Acts 7 and 55. Give me Daniel chapter 7, right, in verse number 13. Right, and we're going to deal with it in his glorified estate, because Christians love to holler, you know, he's not in his glorified estate. So let's deal with it in his glorified estate, Acts 7 and 55. Got it?
I got it?
Bring it up.
This is the book of Acts.
Daniel 7 to 13.
Chapter 7 and verse 55.
Right.
But he, being full of the Holy Ghost,
right,
looked up steadfastly into heaven,
right,
and saw the glory of God,
uh-huh,
and Jesus.
And who?
And Jesus,
uh-huh,
standing on the right hand of God.
How is that possible in the heavens if they're the same people?
That's not what Christians believe.
No, wait. If
you gotta have the right understanding.
Okay, break it down.
So we believe that God is one being,
right?
Three persons.
That doesn't make that. Wait, so, how is that? Wait, hold on.
I got you. I can explain. I'm gonna ask you just one question.
All right.
How would you define love?
Give me the book, the 2 John chapter 1 and verse 6.
In your own words.
Man. No.
Why
no.
Why are you messing up?
No.
That's what I'm saying. How would you define love?
2 John 1 and 6. I'm gonna define it for you.
Okay, go for it.
Right.
This is 2 John 1 and 6.
Bring it up.
And this is love, that we walk after his commandment.
Uh-huh.
This is the commandment that as ye have heard from the beginning, ye should walk in it.
That's your answer.
Okay. So the Ten Commandments, right, they fall essentially summarized in two laws, right? Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength.
The 613 commandments that summarize those two laws, right?
Love your neighbor as yourself.
Correct.
You would say God is love, right?
No. That would be, give me the book of Proverbs chapter 11 and verse 1. We're going to read the Bible. Go to Proverbs 11 and 1. Read this.
This is the book of Proverbs, chapter 11, and verse 1. A false balance.
A what?
A false balance.
A what?
A false balance.
Read on.
Is abomination to the Lord.
Right.
But a just weight.
But a what?
But a just weight.
Uh-huh.
Is his delight.
So, no, he can't be love and only love because that would be a false balance.
I'm not saying he's just only love. I'm asking. Does the Bible say that God is love? Does that, that's all I'm asking.
What scripture says that? Read this.
Isaiah 40 and 1.
Nope. 40 and 7.
7?
Yeah.
Isaiah 40 and 7. The grass 45
and 7.
Oh, 45.
All right.
1 John 4, verse 8.
Okay, read this.
Isaiah 45 and 7. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things.
So if God is specifically just love, why is he saying that he creates evil?
So, did I say he was specific?
We're saying he is love. So when you word it that way.
Yeah, let me clarify. I'm not saying God is only love.
Right.
I'm saying that God, it says in the Bible that God is love.
Okay, so what was your point on that? All right, let me read it. What did you say it was?
It was 1 John 4, verse 8.
Right, read it.
This is the book of 1 John, chapter 4, and verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And this was manifested, the love of God toward us.
Read on.
Because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world.
Read.
That we might live through him.
Right.
Herein is love.
Read.
Not that we loved God, but that he loved us.
Read.
And sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins.
So when it refers to God being love, it's referring to his love that he has for us. Not him being love. It's him and the love that he has for us, to the fact that he sent his only begotten Son to be hung up and die for the people that he loves. Not the fact that God is love the way you worded it. Right? That's not what it's referring to. That's why we have to read the context. And Christians love to say context, but you kind of just pulled that without context.
No, I got you. I was there for a specific reason. That was perfect. Because it goes back to the Ten Commandments, right? How you guys were trying to say, how much you said? 600 commandments?
613 laws. 613. The whole Bible has commandments. It's way more than 600.
Cool. But my point was this. Jesus said, what's the two greatest?
Give me more 12 and 29. Go ahead.
Two greatest commandments, right? It's to love God with all your heart.
We're going to read it.
Soul and strength. Perfect. Read it, right?
This is the book of Mark, chapter 12 and verse 29.
Right.
And Jesus answered him. The first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel.
Hear, O who?
Hear, O Israel.
I have to get that first. Read.
The Lord our God is one Lord.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt love the Lord thy God
right.
with all thy heart and with all thy soul
right.
and with all thy mind
right.
and with all thy strength.
Right.
This is the first commandment.
Read.
And the second is like, namely this.
Like, namely this, which lines up with 1 John. Read on.
Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
Right.
There is none other commandment greater than these.
All right, so what's your point? Because that lines up with 1 John.
Right, you do it. So ask me this. So answer this.
Right? I don't get how this has anything to do with the Trinity. But
I'm not going to the Trinity at all.
Okay, so but that's what we were. I thought we were dealing with the Trinity.
Right, Trinity. Okay, cool.
So we got to stay on one topic.
Yeah, I got you. We stand on the topic of the Trinity, right? So look, tell me this. Would you say that the commandments are true because they reflect God and his character? You say that?
I say the commandments are true because the law is true. Give me the book of Romans chapter 7 and verse 12. Right? Give me the book of Psalms 12 and verse 6. Right? Romans 7 and 12, Acts 12 and 6. Read this.
Psalms 12.
This is the book of Psalms chapter 12 and verse 6. The words of the Lord are pure words.
Are what?
Are pure words.
Read on.
As silver, tried in a furnace of earth.
Right.
Purified seven times.
So it's because it's the word of the Lord. It's pure. That's why the law is what it is, because it's the word of the Lord. It's his perfection. It's the perfection he set out for us to be perfect. Right? Give me the book of Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 5. Read this.
Deuteronomy
This is Romans 7 and 12.
Bring it up.
Wherefore the law is holy,
uh-huh,
and the commandment holy,
right,
and just and good.
And what?
And just and good.
My question again, with both of those scriptures, they simply reflect God's purity, his justice, and his goodness. Do they not?
I don't deny that. No, we're going to read the Bible for understanding, brother.
Right, that's fine, but let's get to it.
Okay.
Anyway, so you would say that God's law, just, good, and pure, right? They reflect who God is. Because he's good, right? So God wouldn't break his commandments, right?
No, he's not going to break his word.
He's not going to break his word.
Right.
So
to say he wouldn't break his, he doesn't have a commandment. His commandment was to us, not to him. So we can't say he wouldn't break his commandments because it's his commandment to us, not to him. He can do what he wants. If he wanted to, but he's not going to. He doesn't need to. Why do people lie? Think about why people have to lie. Would an angel lie? No, because he doesn't need to. When did Satan lie? Give me an account of Satan telling a lie.
In the garden, do you not believe Satan was the one in the garden?
No.
Okay, you don't? Okay,
no. And we can prove that. But nonetheless, I want an account where Satan told a lie.
Okay, perfect. When he was talking to Jesus.
What lie did he tell?
Pull it up.
Luke 4 and 4. What lie did Satan tell? Like, I am confounded. What lie did he tell? He didn't tell a lie.
So when he said, I will give you all the kingdoms of the earth if you simply bow down. Was he telling the truth?
Yes.
Okay.
I can prove that in the Bible as well.
Okay. You can prove that he was telling the truth.
Yes. Right? Well, hold on. Let me ask you a question. Who's the God of this world?
Satan.
So he has the power to give you the kingdoms of this world.
To give you and I.
To give any man that serves him, he has the ability and the power to give him the world. Give me Job 9:24.
This is the book of Job, chapter 9 and verse 24. The earth is given into the hand of the wicked.
Uh-huh.
He covereth the faces of the judges thereof.
Now, that's the so-called white man. He's the wicked. And the earth is in his hand. Why? Because he worships Satan.
That's right.
The same way that he tempted Christ and said, if you worship me, I'll give you all the kingdoms of the earth, right? It literally says, and set Satan at his right hand, man. You don't understand prophecy. If I was going to Revelation 13 right now, and you understood what was going on in Revelation 13, you would know that Satan literally gave the so-called white man the authority and the power over the earth. Because that's what Revelation 13 tells you. But you don't understand that because you don't keep the commandments. Not fully.
Right.
You got
right.
a beard, but you don't keep the commandments fully.
That's right.
Right? So, yes, Satan told the truth. He didn't tell a lie. So once again, angels don't have to lie.
Okay.
Now, they can put a lying spirit on you, but they don't got to tell no lie.
So, getting back to the topic, Jesus being God, right? We talked about God being...
You mean John 17 and 1. I'm listening, brother.
Yeah, so we talked about the commandments being pure, just, and good, right? They simply reflect who God is. Part of the law was to love your neighbor as yourself. My question is,
James chapter 1,
God
verse 10.
God being love, right? Would you agree God was loving? Eternally loving? Would you agree that?
To who?
I'm glad you asked.
He's eternally loving to who?
I'm glad you asked. I would say it's Jesus. Jesus, or God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit.
Read John 17.
John 17 and 1,
you know?
These words spake Jesus.
Spoke who?
Spake Jesus.
Read on.
And lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father.
Said who?
Father.
Is he talking to himself right now? Read on.
The hour is come.
Right.
Glorify thy son, that thy son also may glorify thee.
Now, why in the hell would God need somebody to help him be glorified? Read on.
As thou hast given him power over all.
Wait, brother. Listen.
As thou hast given him power over all flesh.
Thou hast what?
Thou hast given him power over all flesh.
So God needed to be given power? Read.
That he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him.
Right, read.
And this is life eternal.
Read.
That they might know thee.
They know who?
They might know thee.
The what?
The only true God.
The what?
The only true God.
What did Christ say?
The only true God.
Read.
And
addition to. That's what we learned in English, right? And means in addition to. Read.
And Jesus Christ.
And who?
And Jesus Christ.
Are they the same person? Read on.
Whom thou hast sent.
Who thou hast what?
Whom thou hast sent.
How in the hell God sent himself? You know what? I sent. I've sent my damn self. I sent myself.
I called myself, told myself, myself said.
Is God, is, wait, no. Salak, we are going to have to address the things that were read. We're not going to leave the things that were read. Help us understand what that means. No, but you have to help me understand what that means.
I'm not saying that God the Father is Jesus. I'm saying there's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit.
But you said that they're one. You said he's one entity with that are three people. That you said they're one person is three people. That's me being three people. That's what you said. Yes. That's not possible. The scriptures are not saying that.
So does the Old Testament say that God shares glory with anyone?
No, he does not share his glory with anybody. What does that mean? Are we going to deal with the scriptures in John 17?
This is East John 17.
I know. Are we going to deal with what we just read?
I'm going to read down to here.
But you can't. Give me your exegesis.
This is it.
On the breakdown on John 17, 1 and 5. I need that breakdown. I need to understand why Christ needed to receive power from somebody else when he is God. I need to get that understanding. I need you to break that thing down, man. Why did Christ need power from somebody? Right. Why were people given to Christ by somebody if he is that somebody?
Right.
I need you to break that down. We're not moving from that. Because if you brought out, you asked me to go to 1 John, and I stayed right there. I didn't have to go anywhere else. I stayed right there, and I said, look, that's not the context. We read from verse 1 for the context in John 17.
Right.
So give me the exegesis on that.
I'm telling you, I'm not arguing that. You're saying that.
Jesus, no, what I'm saying is, listen, in your line of understanding, show me how your line of understanding lines up with what Christ just said in his prayer.
I'm telling you, right, again, what I'm not saying is that God the Father is Jesus. I'm not saying that.
Okay. So what are you saying?
I'm just saying God is one being, three persons.
That's saying that. That's literally saying that God is Jesus.
Listen. You said right that God doesn't share his glory with no one, right?
Right. It's bad. Idolatry, man. It's literal idolatry. People don't understand. You cannot make anybody equal to the Most High God, man. That is off. Why would we need to pray? Give me the book of 1 Timothy 2 and 15. 1 Timothy 2 and 15. Read it.
1 Timothy 2 and 15.
Bring it out.
Notwithstanding, she shall. Nah, that's not.
2 and 5.
Oh, 2 Timothy 2 and 15.
Okay.
No, it's 5. It's 5. 1 Timothy 2 and 5. Yeah, 2 and 5. Yeah, come on. Salakia. Salakia. It's been a minute. It's one of those old precepts, man.
All right. 1 Timothy 2 and 5.
No.
For there is one God,
right,
and one mediator,
right,
between God and men.
Read.
The man, Christ Jesus.
One God and one mediator. How do we deal with that? How can they all be one person and three people when one is a mediator and one is the Most High God? That lines up with what Christ said in Acts 17. Can God be tempted?
No.
Give me the book of Hebrews chapter 2, right? And read, start at verse 12. Read, no, say it, James. Read that. James 1 and 10.
This is the book of James chapter 1 and verse 10.
No.
But the rich in that he is made low, because as the flower of the grass, he shall pass away.
Right.
For the sun is no sooner risen with a burning heat.
Jump to 12.
Verse 12. Blessed is the man that endured temptation.
Right.
For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life.
Read on.
Which the Lord hath promised to them that love him.
Read this.
Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God.
Right.
For God cannot be tempted.
For what?
For God cannot be tempted with evil.
Now, read this. Hebrews 2. Read this. I mean, Hebrews 2. Yeah. 12, yeah, read it.
Hebrews 2 and 12.
Right.
Saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren.
Right.
In the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee.
Read.
And again, I will put my trust in him.
Read.
And again, behold, I and the children which God hath given me.
Read.
For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood,
right,
he also himself likewise took part of the same,
right,
that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil.
Read.
And deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage.
Read.
For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham.
Read.
Wherefore, in all things, it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful.
So hold on. To be what? Like unto his brethren?
He might.
To be what? Wherefore,
in all things, it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren.
To be what?
To be made like unto his brethren.
God can't be made, and we are not God's brethren. Read on. But Christ is our brother.
That's right.
Hold on. Read on.
That he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God.
Now, how can God be a priest unto himself? Read.
To make reconciliation for the sins of the people.
Read.
For in that he himself have suffered being tempted.
Being what?
Being tempted.
Being what?
Being tempted.
Read that. Hold on. Let's read that again in James.
Come on. Bring it back. Right.
This is the book of James, chapter 1, verse 13. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted.
That's a wrap. That's a wrap. That is a no, 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 no. You got to break that thing down. That is a wrap. There is no way around it. No, 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 no.
The answer's in the Bible, right? The Bible
interprets the Bible, right? The Bible, give me Isaiah 28, right, and verse 13. We're not doing that.
So you don't believe where it says, unto us is some of you born, we will be called mighty God. You won't be called
there? Are the Israelites called gods?
Judges, yeah, they are. We're called judges, but he's called mighty God.
So, hold on. Are the Israelites called God?
They're called judges.
They ain't called God?
No, they're not.
Are you sure?
Positive.
You positive? Give me 1 Samuel 28. Nope. Give me 1 Samuel 28 and 13. Nope. We're going to find the brother a liar. We're going to find the brother a liar. Give me 1 Samuel 28 and 13.
This is the book of 1 Samuel chapter 28 and verse 13. And the king said unto her,
right,
be not afraid, but what sawest thou?
Right.
And the woman said unto Saul, I saw gods.
I saw what?
I saw gods.
I saw what?
I saw gods.
Read. Now, who did she see?
She saw Samuel.
So what is Samuel?
He was dead. He was a
what is Samuel?
He was a
no, 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 no. What is Samuel?
He's dead.
An Israelite.
But what is she referring to Samuel as? What is an Israelite woman referring to Samuel as?
A spirit.
Oh, okay. She said, I saw what?
I saw gods.
I saw what?
I saw gods.
This brother is overtly lying. Read.
I saw gods ascending out of the earth.
Out of where?
Out of the earth.
Read on.
And he said unto her, what form is he of?
What form is he of? Read.
And she said, an old man cometh up, and he is covered with a mantle. And Saul perceived that it was Samuel.
It was who?
It was Samuel.
So Israelites are gods. So Israelites are gods. So when you say, when you going into the fact of, yeah, free Palestine. That's right. Free Palestine. Now take your dumb ass up the street.
right? So look, so when we read Isaiah 9, it lines up with the understanding that Israelites are God. Did they not want to stone Christ for calling himself a God? And he says, does it not say in your law that ye are gods? But he is the king of the Israelites. So he's mightier than every other Israelite.
That's right.
What does archangel mean? What does archangel mean? Right? Why what is the difference between an archangel and all the other angels? Look it up. Why is Michael and Gabriel and Uriel different than the other angels? What makes them different? What makes Christ even more different than them? Give me Joshua 5. I'm going to show you why he was called Mighty God.
I hope you're missing it, brother.
Take your notes.
Right? Give me Joshua 5. I'm going to show you why.
Listen, brother. Love you, brother.
Right? 5 and I think it should be 15.
This is the book of Joshua, chapter 5 and verse 13. And the captain of the Lord's host.
And the what?
And the captain of the Lord's host.
What is Christ?
And the captain of the Lord's host. Host means army.
So the reason why he's referred to as Mighty God is because he is the mighty God. He is above the rest of the gods, which are the Israelites.
That's right.
He is the leader. He is the king. That's why it's referred to as that. Not because he is the most high God. Right? He has a beginning and an end. Right? Can God die?
No.
Can God die? Right? You keep asking me to go. You're not dealing with nothing. We done brought out so many precepts, and it's like nothing is getting dealt with. Just cognitive dissonance. Somebody pull up in the dictionary the definition of cognitive dissonance, man. Somebody pull that up, man. Cognitive dissonance, man. You got Siri.
I got it.
Read it.
It's the state of having inconsistent thoughts, beliefs, or attitude, especially as related to behavior, decision, and attitude change.
Read. It's another definition. You gotta hit that Merriam-Webster, man. I ain't go to college, but I know Merriam-Webster. There it is.
Psychological conflict.
What is it?
Psychological conflict resulting from incongruous beliefs and attitudes held simultaneously.
You see, psychological conflict resulting from beliefs. So because of your beliefs, you won't accept what the Bible is coming out with, man. Right. You can't pick up what we're laying down. We can go anywhere, but what's the point of us going places if when we break it down, you don't deal with it, man? I just dealt with the Almighty. It's just like, let's go to John 17. Like, we can't do that, man. You got to deal with the things that are being brought out, man. Right? We're not going, this is not a merry-go-round. It's not do-si-do. You know, no, brother. I'm going scripture to scripture to break scriptures down.
Right.
I'm actually breaking the word down. You're not. You're not. You still haven't broke down John 17, 1 through 4. You didn't break down. You didn't break down anything else.
Give him no chance.
Give him no chance. There we go. All right,
break it down.
You gonna break it down?
Break it down.
You gonna break down the fact that God can't be tempted, but they said Christ was tempted.
Yeah, he was God in human form. John 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And the Word was God.
What?
Verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory.
What? Do you understand? Do you understand that John 1 literally cuts your understanding?
17 and 5
cut his understanding. I know he don't want that. There's no point in going there. The whole 17 cuts his understanding.
What does 5 say?
The whole 17. Thou hast manifested thy name to those that thou hast given me. Like the whole thing cuts his understanding. It's bad. It doesn't make sense. But it's cognitive dissonance. Go ahead.
John 17 and 5.
Bring it on.
And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was.
But I thought God don't share his glory with nobody.
He just said, glorify me with the glory that I had with you before the earth was.
It's not what it's talking about.
It isn't?
No.
What is he talking about?
Give me the book. Give me the book of Acts chapter 1. And 9. 1 and 9.
Right? Same argument. Jumping, right?
You just said, no, I'm going to literally show you what the I'm going to show you what it's referring to, man.
Okay, now you run into another passage.
No, I'm going to show you what the glorification he's asking for is that was with him from the beginning.
That you had me
over. Nah, you don't got to read that. It ain't no point. Right? Read Acts 1.
This is the book of Acts, chapter 1 and verse 9,
right?
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up.
He was what?
He was taken up.
He was what?
He was taken up.
Read.
And a cloud received him out of their sight.
So he's just talking about going back into his glorified estate, man. He's just talking about going back into the third heaven. That's what he's talking about. That's where he was in the beginning. He was in the third heaven. He's saying, receive me back into the third heaven as I was from the beginning. It's not a deep understanding.
So you just told me earlier, don't.
You're not talking about the same. You're not the glory. See, this is the problem. It's the problem with you Christians. Y'all see a word and you think it means the same thing every time. When no language is that way. No language. I can use a word for many different understandings in the English language. But the soonest in the Bible, oh, does he share his glory with another? That's not glory. His glory, like his praise, is unto him. His glory for him being the deliverer of Israel, the true savior of Israel, that's unto him. Him being the one and only true God, that's unto him. But being glorified in a glorified estate, that's not talking about the glory of the Most High God. It's not the same thing.
What does it say that in that passage, John 17:5?
It don't have to say it. It's called understanding. It's called understanding. After everything that Christ said before that right there means that it's talking about he has the same glory as the Most High God. That's the problem. That doesn't line up with none of the rest of the chapter, but because you want to believe it, that's what it means. Brother, I read 1 through 5, and I went there to show you what type of glory it's talking about. That's what I'm doing. That's why he told I believe it was Peter, touch me not, for I have not yet ascended. So, once again, how do we deal with God not being able to be tempted, and it says that Christ was tempted? How do we deal with that? Don't tell me, well, he was in a man like a that don't line up. It don't matter. The scripture says God can't be tempted. It didn't say can't be tempted except in his man like a state. It doesn't say that. It's not in there. You adding. What precept can we go to where it says that God can only be tempted in his man like a state? Give me the precept. Quick.
John chapter
1 don't say that.
In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God.
Give me Colossians 2.
Right? With God, and the word was God. You got to do that, man.
Give me Colossians 2 and 14. The word was with God. With God. How is the word with God, but he is God? Absolute madness.
What does it mean then?
Colossians 2.
Said two. Two is
black. Yeah, one. One. So lucky.
All right, this is Colossians 1:14.
Nope.
I'll start at 13, so maybe you understand. Colossians 1:13, who have delivered us from the power of darkness and have translated us into the kingdom of his dear son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Who is the image of the invisible God?
Who is the what?
Who is the image of the invisible God?
No, he is God.
Who is the image of the invisible God?
How do we deal with that?
Again, you're making an argument that I'm not making.
No. You're making an argument that they're, you are literally, it's like you don't understand what your argument is. Your argument is that they're the same, but they're different, but they're the same. But it's just him, but it's three of them. That's saying that he is God. You can't say that they're one and the same, but three different people, and not say that he is God.
Co-equal, co-eternal.
How can you be co-equal and what scripture says co-equal, co-eternal?
He doesn't have to say that's what you
can. Oh.
He doesn't have to.
Oh.
Does it say
now it don't have to say something?
Does it say the Israelites are God?
Yes.
No, it does not. It's talking about.
Give me Psalms. Give me Psalms. Psalms. Psalms 82 and 6. It's bad. Read it.
This is the book of Psalms, chapter 82 and verse 6.
I saw the verse 5.
Go ahead.
Verse 5. They know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course.
Read.
I have said, ye are God.
Ye are what?
Ye are God.
Ye are what?
Ye are God.
What did the Lord say?
Ye are God.
What are the Israelites?
Ye are gods. And all of you are children of the Most High.
Read.
But ye shall die like men.
Who is he talking to in that passage? Talking to the
Israelites. It's a heavenly court. Is it not in that passage? Start from the beginning. Verse 1. He's talking to a heavenly court. Is he not?
He's talking to the Israelites.
In heaven, he's talking to the Israelites.
Verse 1. Why? Explain to me why Samuel was referred to as a god.
He was a spirit. He was dead.
So because when you're a spirit, you Elohim, become a god.
Other Elohim.
Alahayim in the Hebrew, not Elohim.
Elohim,
and Alahayim means God, gods, or powers. So what you're doing is you are making a point that is cutting you. We're still saying that they're God. Just you're admitting that they're God. But are they only gods whenever they're in a spiritual realm? No, because the Lord says, "Ye shall not revile the gods in the law." Was he saying then that you can't revile the idolatrous gods? No, he's saying not to revile your judges. Your judges are gods. They're rulers. They're gods.
Judges. I literally said that earlier.
Brother, do you understand?
He's talking about judges.
Do you understand?
I said that already.
Do you understand, brother, that the term gods are relegated to being a judge, a ruler, or an angel? That's what it means. So when you talk about the term God, you're the one that makes it more than what we're making it. We have a complete understanding of what gods are. So Christ is a God, and he's a God above us. But he is not the Most High God, and he is not equal to the Most High God. He was created. How could go back to Colossians. Finish it off.
Colossians 1 and 14. In whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature.
The first what?
The firstborn of every creature.
Now, how in the hell are they co-equal, co-eternal, when it's saying right here that Christ was born, created? How can he be equal to the Lord when the Lord created him?
Colossians 1 and 14, verse.
That is madness. You can't. And instead of you believing in the Lord and in the Bible, you rather believe in your dogma and your doctrine. And that is sad. Hey, what do we gain from discrediting the Trinity?
Nothing.
But what do you gain by keeping the Trinity? Death. I would want to study hard to get up out of that thing, man, rather than trying to study hard to prove it. That don't help you. There's no salvation in lifting up Christ as the Most High God. None. You don't realize what you're doing. Right? Finish it off, King.
Colossians 1 and 15.
No, 16.
It says, "For by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him."
How things are created for him by the Most High God, but yet he is the Most High God. Now he equal to the Lord, but the Lord had to create things for him. The Lord is saying, hey, give me Psalms 110. Psalms 110. Read Psalms 110. From the top.
This is the book of Psalms, chapter 110, from the top. The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit down at my right hand.
Do what?
Sit down at my right hand.
Read on.
Until I make.
No, until we.
Until I make.
No, until both of us.
Until I make.
Right.
Thine enemies thy footstool.
Now, they're co-equal. But yet, the Most High God has to make his enemies his footstool. He couldn't do it on his own. Confounded. Confounded.
So, going back, you said Colossians 1, right?
Right.
Talking about Jesus being the firstborn.
Right.
What does that word mean, firstborn? And then I'm going
to
say...
Firstborn, it literally means to be begotten. In the Greek, it means begotten. Literally, in the Greek.
So, what about...
And it says to be created, to be begotten, to be born.
So what about Psalms 89, verse 27, talking about King David? I also shall make him my firstborn, the highest of the kings.
There you go again with those words. But there you go again with those words. No, because this is, as I'm telling you, the moment that a word says the same word, it's literally, it means the same thing. It does not mean the same thing. Was David his literal firstborn?
No, I'm asking, was David the first king of Israel?
No.
All right, then, why does it say he's going to make him the firstborn king among all the...
Give me the book of Exodus, chapter 4, and verse 22. Absolutely.
You answering the question?
Absolutely. Read it.
This is the book of Exodus, chapter 4, and verse 22.
Read it up.
And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn.
Even my what?
Even my firstborn.
Was Israel the firstborn nation? First created nation?
Exactly. That's my whole point, brother.
No,
that's
you...
my first point. It doesn't mean firstborn as in Jesus was the first that God created.
No. This is bad, brother. Hold on, brother. This is bad. This is bad. Listen. Yes, he is the first thing that the Lord created. When the term firstborn being applied to men just represents their favoritism with the Lord. So when it talks about the favoritism of Israel, it tells them that they're the firstborn because he is the king. And the king of kings, the firstborn is the heir of everything that the king has. That's why the Israelites are the heir of everything the Most High has to offer to men. Now, with David was his chosen king. That's why Christ came out of the loins of David, although he didn't come out the physical loins of David. Because David was his chosen king. That's all it's referring to in the book of Psalms. Dealing with Christ being created has nothing to do with what you're talking about. Christ was still created. Because David, was he not created? Was David created?
David was created.
Was Israel created? Was Christ created?
He was born. He was created.
Then he can't be equal to God. No. Stop. He cannot be equal to God because God created him.
So didn't you say earlier that
brother, stop. No, because I'm getting angry now. Stop. 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 No, brother, I'm getting angry because this is getting bad. Brother, hold on. Hold on, brother. Hold on. Hold on. Brother, hold on, brother. Brother, hold on. Brother, hold on.
You read it already.
Brother, hold on.
Jesus was what? He was the captain of the host, right?
That's a feminine
man. Your peace, bro. Be a man. Be a man. Hold your peace.
I'm a man. Answer the question. Was Jesus in the Old Testament? You read the passage, did you not? The answer is yes. You read it. But you're saying here, Jesus is created. How can Jesus be created if he was in the Old Testament as well?
No, I'm not. No. Nope.
You want him to answer your question, but you don't want to answer that.
I am asking questions. I'm telling you, my answer is as simple as this. Y'all not satisfied with my answer. That's it. That's all I'm telling you. Because you guys are making a straw man argument. My argument is
a straw man argument with Bible scriptures that this brother cannot explain.
So you telling me,
brother, stop, man. This is bad, bro. Like, this is bad. No. I'm not doing this. I'm not doing this anymore.
I don't want to do this
anymore. I'm not doing this anymore. This is a wrap. Yes, goodbye.
I'll be over here waiting.
You know I'm not going to talk to you.
All right,
give me Titus 3 and 10.
All right, man. See y'all.
No, man, I'm not going in circles with people that don't really believe in the Bible. That is stupid. The brother don't believe in the Bible.
The Bible is coming out. The scriptures are coming out. He won't deal with no scriptures at all that come out. None. That don't make sense. Read it.
Titus 3:10. A man that is inherited after the first and second admonition reject.
Do what?
Reject.
Do what?
Reject.
Do what?
Reject.
The Lord say to reject these men, man. We're not finna sit here and go back and forth with men that don't want to literally go say to me, yes, Christ was created. But won't recuse the fact that if he's created by God, he cannot be equal to God. That is absolute madness. We don't got to go nowhere else. We read, I asked him, could God be tempted? No. We read the scripture about Christ being tempted. Don't want to deal with it. Nothing gets dealt with, man. If I'm going to have a reasonable debate, at least let us debate in the scriptures and you reconcile the things that are being brought out.
Right.
You bring out a point, I reconcile it. I bring out a point, you don't reconcile it. You run to another point. This is madness, man. This is what Christianity has done to our people, man. Literally what it's done to our people, destroyed the minds of our people, man. And it's sad, man. Right? What time is it, man? With that, quote that seller.
Quote that seller!